Man, I tell you what, I love churches that give away dessert. You know what I mean? Cake. Isn't that great? That's awesome. Well, hey, thanks so much for being here this morning. My name is Tom Blount. I'm the campus pastor here in Imlay City. I need to do something over the next couple weeks. If last week you already filled out one of my new prayer cards, do not raise your hand unless you're wanting to redo your prayer card and maybe put something out. Guys are going to come forward. Raise your hand if you do not have one of these. And here's the deal. I love these. I get to pray for you. So raise your hand if you haven't filled one of these out yet. Fill it out with whatever you feel comfortable. This does not go to anybody. These are mine. They stay with me. They went to work with me a couple times this week. They sit right next to my chair where I like to read often. And so I've been able to get to read these things over. In fact, yours on the front page right there, will you? That's the right front page right there. But anyway, so please make sure you fill these out. Raise your hand if you haven't filled one out yet. And then at the end, if you could just remember, just drop it off in the offering plate. I would consider it an honor and a privilege to be able to pray for you. And it's just been a blessing. I should have done this when I first came, but for some reason I did not. And so I thank the Lord. Look at that. I mean, I get to pray for all these, and then you're going to add to it. And then there's other people I get to pray for, but very, very excited. Hey, listen, I don't know where you're at in your prayer life, but we're in the very midst of 21 days of prayer, praying the King's agenda. Yesterday, we had a guy come up from Heritage Church, Sterling Heights, and share with us during our time of prayer at 9 o'clock. And I know the weather's been really bad for a couple of those days, and then last week was bad. Maybe you couldn't make it out last week and you missed out. Look, jump in. Don't worry about it. Here's the thing that I think a lot of people have mistakenly thought in their time with serving the Lord or getting to know the Lord. It's like, oh man, I dropped the ball. I told the Lord that I would read my Bible every day in January 1st, and man, things got rolling good because, you know, Genesis is pretty interesting. And when you're going to Genesis, Exodus, that's not bad. But when you start getting into Leviticus, it's like, what is this stuff? You know, and so you draw back a little bit. Or maybe even the first week out of the gate, you just kind of drop the ball. Look, here's what I want to encourage you. Anytime you just step out a little bit or you didn't read yesterday or you don't think you, look, pick up where you left off. Enjoy your relationship with God. Look, he's not looking down on you with this great big club of retribution that he's waiting for you to just get off kilter a little bit so he can hit you. That's not the kind of God we serve. Our God absolutely loved us so much and still loves us is that he sent his only begotten son, Jesus, to the cross of Calvary. He sent him to this world. He lived a sinless life, and he died upon the cross for you and I, and he loves you. So we're going to get into the Word of God today because I want to encourage you, just as I hope to encourage you during the time of Holy Communion, I want to encourage you today. We've had three messages as far as prayer, praying the King's agenda. And if you don't have a booklet, by all means, out there in the lobby area, just see somebody. See myself, see Pastor Kyle, see anybody, go over towards the area where the kiosk is there at the door and tell them, hey, I want a prayer book. Pick up right at day 14 today. You'll be fine. And then you can go back around and pick it up again and do it. And so you'll have a great, great time and just learn some beautiful, beautiful truths from the Word of God about praying the King's agenda. Now, last year, during the midst of our time together, we actually looked at the prayer of Jabez. Now, many of you are going to go, that's the same message. And I'm going to tell you honestly, same outline. Absolutely the same outline. Now, here's something very interesting. As I was re-studying all of this, I got to thinking, you know, I don't know about you, but prayer's pretty important. And when I look into the Word of God and see some different things about what's actually taking place, what I notice that takes place in our lives is this, is that it is God's desire, which my true heart's desire is God's desire, but God's desire is that you would live a blessed life. And he wants you to understand that you are blessed if you are a child of God, and it was never based upon anything you ever did. The only thing you really did was you said, I can't, but you can. I'm asking you to forgive me of my sins and come into my heart. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. But you did nothing to deserve salvation. And that's what's so amazing about God's amazing grace. But here's the thing. Do you realize that there's not a person seated here today, an individual standing back there up in the area serving, out in the areas where we have different departments, big kids, little kids, and then greeting and all that stuff, myself included. There's not a person here that doesn't have pain in their life or hasn't had pain in their life, hasn't gone through something. We all have had pain in our life, but here's the thing. We make a choice on what we're going to do with that pain. On how we're going to respond to it. Look, nobody signs up for it and says, hey, you know what, on Tuesday, I cannot wait because there's going to be so much pain in my life in a relationship that I believe is just going to be, like, destroyed. Nobody goes, that's top on my list. That's my 2020 New Year's resolution is I can't wait to have pain. It says rejoice in your sufferings, rejoice in the things that you go through. It's not like, oh, I love this. It's rejoice in Him in the midst of it. So we have all had pain, but we choose, each and every one of us, how we're going to respond to that pain. So let me ask you this question. Jot this down. It's not in your notes. Jot this down and make it personal in your notes. You need to jot this down in the handout that you received, the program. There's a little notes section. Jot this down. What will I do with the pain that I experience? Just jot it down. What will I do with the pain that I've experienced? You could put experienced or will experience. You see what I'm saying? Because you've already experienced something. I've already said that. But we will experience something in the future. So what will I do? What will Tom do in the midst of his pain in 2020? What will Tom do with all the pain in the past? Because here's what I want you to understand. The prayer of Jabez is a prayer from pain that produced an unbelievable amount of power to the glory of God because of God's purpose. Let me say that again. The prayer of Jabez was an unbelievable prayer from pain to produce unbelievable power to live out God's plan of what He would produce and what He could do for His purpose. So we find Jabez in the Old Testament. And just really, really in simplicity, I want you to understand that with Jabez and how he lived his life, I want you to know this. It's okay. Because some people will say, well, it's not okay for me to ask God to bless me. Yes, it is. We're going to get to that in just a moment. It is okay for God, for you to actually tell God, God, enlarge my territory. You say, but I'm having a hard time with the territory I got right now. I get that. Many of us have grown to the point that we could step out of that area. Lord, enlarge my territory or deliver me from evil. Now listen, deliver me from temptation. Deliver me from anybody who wants to form a weapon against me. Word of God says, no weapon shall be formed against you that shall prevail. It doesn't say that weapons won't be formed. But by God's grace in us calling to Him, there is no weapon that can be formed against you or me that will prevail. So it's what are we going to do with that pain? You see, what are we going to do in that situation? So it's okay to say, God, bless me. It's okay to say, God, enlarge my territory. It's okay to absolutely ask God, deliver us from evil, and then expect Him to grant your request. This is something that I looked at. I knew this before, but I didn't know how many, and then I didn't really say it to you, but it's an interesting thing. I don't know about you, but I get a little curious sometimes about, okay, how many mentions of so-and-so is there in the Bible, or how many mentions of so-and-so is there in the Bible, or how many times did he talk about grace, or how many times did he talk about finances or prayer? How many times did he? So I did a real quick search, and you probably already knew this, and so just please, you can just take a little nap here just for this little piece here. But the Bible contains 23,145 verses in the Old Testament, and in the New Testament, there's 7,957 verses, totaling 31,102. 31,102. Now, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but some of you have read all 31,102, and there's some that you've memorized. Now, here's the thing before we get into our verse. Jabez is only mentioned in two verses. In 31,102, he's mentioned twice. Two verses. That's not 1%. That's not a quarter percent. It's 0.00006. You say, how'd you figure it out? Oh, I just did a math problem. I'm not good at math, but I thought, I wonder what the percentages of that. And then I got to thinking, I don't even know what that 0.00006, I think it was like 4.5 or 5.4. I don't know what that represents. Like, do you say like it's a quarter of a quarter of a quarter? I don't know. But somebody come out there that's really, really smart. And I know somebody's already going, well, that's simple. You just take the point and then you move it. And then, hey, good for you. Good for you. How'd that work for you? And then I thought, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to look up and see how many times the name Thomas is in the Bible. And then the Lord spoke to me and said, no, don't do that. And I thought, well, why, Lord? I was actually talking to him, and I'm like, well, why? He said, because some people's names aren't in the Bible, and then they're really going to get bummed out. Like, is there like a... I can't say it because somebody might get offended. You know what I mean? So you see what I'm saying? So he talked to me. But here's the thing. And then I thought about my name. I'm like, no, I don't really want to point that out because usually my name is like Doubting Thomas. I'm like, oh, thank you, Lord. Appreciate that. Every time my mom and dad called, hey, Thomas, Tommy, it reminded me that I was what? You're a doubter, loser, right? So I didn't do that. So let's get right into the word today and see what 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 9 and 10 say. Jabez, and you can circle that name or do whatever you want, but it actually means pain, okay? Honestly, we'll get to that in a moment. It says, Jabez was more honorable than his brothers. Now, here's the deal. I wonder what his brothers were named. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, hey, Jabez, you are a pain in my side. But the brothers, I wonder what their names were. We won't go into that. But his mother had named him Jabez, saying, I gave birth to him in pain. Jabez cried out to the God of Israel and said this, oh, that you would bless me and enlarge my territory. Let your hand be with me and keep me from harm so that I will be free from pain. And look what God said. God granted his request. Now, before you go down the line and say, well, yeah, but I've asked God a lot of things and he didn't grant my request. I get that. But let's get right into this, and hopefully, God, I'm asking you through your spirit, speak to your people. I'm hoping that you'll get the answer that you need today because God knows my heart. I want to be a blessing. But the only way that I know that I can be is if he hides me behind the finished work of the cross. I want you to see Jesus, not me today. So let's get right into it. Jot this down. Pray for blessing. Now, I will spend more time right here than any other point because I need you to understand in this point, this is so important. Because if you don't realize and believe today when you walk out these doors that you can pray for a blessing, then the rest isn't even going to come into context. I'm dead serious. The first thing he asked for what? He said, bless me. So 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 10 says, oh, that you would bless me. Bless me. Now, the psalmist says this in Psalm chapter 18, verse 35. He says, you give me your shield of victory, and your right hand sustains me. Anytime you ever read of the right hand of God, that means power. In strength, you give me a shield for victory, and your right hand sustains me. You stoop down to make me great. Hey, I love what the psalmist said. He said, man, you brought me up out of the miry clay, the dirt and the mire and the grub and all that it was, and you put my feet on solid ground. You give me a shield for victory, and your right hand sustains me, and you stoop down to make me great. Now, Genesis says this because you have to catch this because what a lot of people will say was, yeah, but I'm not there. I'm not in that timeline. I'm not here. Genesis, when God's speaking to Abraham, says to him, I will bless you and you will be a blessing to others. Here's the thing about blessings, and God already knows what you're going to do with them. Are you going to be a blessing to others when he blesses you? Now, some of you I've watched, he's blessed you so tremendously. You open your house up, and you're a connector, and you do groups, and you have people over your house, and you do things with people, and you step out of your comfort zone. You say, well, I don't do that all the time. Hey, do it. Because God has blessed you. Step out of your comfort zone and be a blessing to somebody. Just host. Be a group connector, you see. He says to Abraham, Abraham, I'm going to bless you. As the stars of the heaven, as the sands of the earth, I'm going to bless you. Your name is going to be great. But I want you to understand, I'm blessing you that you would be a blessing. And so I wonder many times if we're not recognizing those blessings because we're just holding on to them. I ain't sharing them. I got to save them all. And he said, bless me. Blessed, empowered to succeed. That's what blessed actually gives the idea of. Power to succeed. You are empowered by the grace of God to succeed. Now, cursed to be defined and confined, I said this probably over a year ago. Cursed is defined and confined of our past and our pain. Here's the deal. We have been imprisoned by our past and we have been imprisoned by our pain. We allow many times those things that break us has defined us and has confined us. Not only have we allowed the pain of the past to define who we are, people know you. They almost step back thinking, man, they're not too friendly. They don't walk across the room. I want you to think about this. Do you know or are you an individual that you've allowed the pain of the past to define you and confine you to how you live today? And that's normal for everybody. It's that we have to break through this by the grace of God to say, no, I'm not letting my pain of the past to capture me and define me any longer and confine me to where I'm at. I'm going to get out of my comfort zone, man. I'm going to put a smile on my face. Yeah, but that's just faking it. Look, everybody wears a mask. But what it really boils down to is, are you just faking it all the time, or are you finding out that in Christ, you are tremendously far more blessed than the pain of your past? That's something I'm trying to work on and learn. See, God wants us to live the blessed life. And actually, many of you don't know this, but on Tuesday nights, Josh Klein actually leads a Celebrate Recovery program that you could go step by step in a Celebrate Recovery program and not allow the pains of the past anymore to define who you are and confine you where you're at and break through and to see who Jesus really is. You ought to check it out. You say, but that's just for like chemical addictions like drugs or alcohol or sex or pornography. No, it's for anything that has a stronghold in your life. And so come on out and check that out. Get a hold of Josh Klein and see that. Expect more in your life and dare to believe that God has so much more for you. Jot this verse down because it's not in your notes. You're going to love this verse. John 7:17 says this. John 7:17 says, anyone who wants to do the will of God will know whether my teaching is from God or is merely my own. Here's a key in walking with Jesus. If you're not willing, it don't work. If you're not willing to do whatever it takes, hey, listen, you'll fight and move on and go forward to do things that you desire to do and you want to see happen in your family's life, or I want that new car, or I want that new snowmobile, and nothing's wrong with that, by the way. If you bought a new sled this week, hey, great. Just wait till next week. You have to get a boat. I've often thought about having a pool. In Michigan, having a pool is like having 3 good days to swim in it. And 2 of those days, I'm probably at work. You know what I mean? You just wonder about that. Having a sled is like, well, if you don't leave here and go way to the UP, you ain't going to have any fun because around here, we just don't get much snow. It's like having a fishing boat. You know what I'm saying? It rains on the days you're off, and it's bad fishing. It goes on. There's nothing wrong with what you have, but what you have, does it have you? You see the difference? So listen, bottom line is what we see here is, are you willing to do whatever it takes? You need to be willing. Ephesians says this, when we're willing, Jot this down, Ephesians 3:20, God who is able through his mighty power at work within us to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or think of. Far beyond what you could ever dream up or imagine, God is able to do more. Why? Because you just say, hey, God, I don't know how it's going to work, but I'm willing. Speak to me. I'm going to bless me. Bless me, Lord. God wants you to live above fear. God desires that you would live without anxiety. God desires that you would not have stress and poverty and sickness. You would actually live over sin and not be dominated by the things of the world. God wants you to live a blessed life, to be a blessing. And to be a blessing is the secret to having dominion that God desires that you would walk in, and that the blessing is the fruit. The word says that we will be known by our fruit. Blessing is a multiplier. Blessing is a game changer in your life. And blessings only come because of the finished work of the cross. So the blessing is all that God has for you and desires for you. So here's what I want you to jot down. Four little things underneath point one that says, God, bless me. Here's what I want. You're praying for a blessing, and there's the four things I want you to jot down right here underneath this. Number one is this. You need to understand that the blessed life is God's will for your life. The blessed life is God's will for your life. You say, what do you mean? Here's number two. Jot this down. The blessed will was God's idea from the beginning. We just talked about that. You could reverse those if you want. It is his plan. It's his will for your life, but it is his idea. Or you could say, hey, it's God's idea that I live the blessed life, and it is his will for my life. But here's the other thing you need to jot down. The blessed life is God's purpose for my life. Here's what I said. Do you remember when I said blessed means that you are empowered to succeed? Well, if it's God's idea and it's God's will, number two, then you have to understand that the blessing that God gives and the blessed life that God has for you is his purpose. And you could say that's his power. It's his power to rise up and live above everything else in your life. But the last thing is, it's the blessed life is the right as a child of God. You have a right to live as a child of God in the blessing of God. Here's the thing. Can you imagine, as what Scripture said, Jabez's mom said, you know what, I'm calling him Jabez because it means pain. It means pain. That every time you heard your name, you were reminded of pain. Now, some of you may be in a place in your life where you say, Pastor Tom, that just seems like that's what it is in my life. If it isn't this, it's another thing. If it isn't this, it's another thing. You got to get rid of that stinking thinking that it's always going to be that way, because God's blessed life for you is his idea. God's blessed life for you is his will for your life. God's blessed life for you is his purpose, meaning his power to rise you up. And God's blessed life is your right because you're a child of God. You said, that doesn't make sense. Hey, listen, if you jot this down, I want you to check this out. In Galatians, it says this in chapter 3, verse 29, it says this, and now that you belong to Christ, if you at any point in your life, I'm not talking about religion, I'm not talking about anything that you did just as a bunch of prayers, I'm not talking about a denomination, I'm talking about that moment when you recognize that in your sin, if you died without Christ, you would not go to heaven, you would go to hell, is that you cried out to God, because Romans says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, that you said, you know what, I'm calling upon the name of the Lord to be saved. At that moment, in Galatians, he says, if you belong to Christ, you are the true children of Abraham. Do you remember when I read to you Genesis 12? He said, I'm going to bless you so you be a blessing. If you're a child of Christ, you are a true child of Abraham, and you are his heirs, and God's promise to Abraham belongs to you. It is your right. It's his idea. It's his will. It's his purpose, which is his power. And it is your right to live the blessed life. Because here's the thing. Please jot this down. And I'm going to go into the last couple notes. And we're going to close. You got to get this. In Hebrews, many of us don't come to God because we feel filthy, we feel dirty, we feel condemned, or I did it again, or I can't seem to get it right. And you're living underneath this cloud of condemnation. But if you're his child, remember, you are his child, then you are an heir. And so he says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16, he says, so let us come boldly to the throne of grace, our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy and we will find grace to help us in the most needed time. How about now? Is that a good time? Do you have any need? Do you have any desire to break through from where you're at? He said you could come boldly. That's not arrogance. That is because, as we talked about in Holy Communion, because of his shed blood, because you said, I can't, but you can, because you received him, he said, you're my child. You can come right in boldly before the throne of grace. That's awesome that you get to come before God, a holy God, all because of Jesus Christ. Finished work. So we pray for a blessing, but jot this next thing down. Pray for what? Influence. Pray for influence. He says here in 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 10, enlarge my territory. Enlarge my territory. Now, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18 says this, I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened. I love that. Enlightened in order that you may know, not think, not imagine, not hope for, that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints. Man, he loves you so much. You have inherited way more than you can ever think of or imagine. And you need to cry out to him and say, God, I'm asking for influence. And he'll mold you and make you, because as the psalmist said in Psalm chapter 2, verse 8, ask me, he says, and I will make the nations your inheritance, the ends of the earth your possessions. Look, I don't know what your hopes and dreams are, but I got an idea that your hopes and dreams are actually better than where you are today. Nothing wrong with that. Paul said, I've learned and continually learning to be content where I'm at. But we don't have to be satisfied. Can we reach another? Can our influence impact another for the cause of Christ? Can we move forward and see unbelievable results in this community as we point people to Jesus Christ? So we pray for a blessing. We pray for influence, but we also pray for presence. Now, we just left Christmas. Make sure you spell it right. Presence. I want you to know, this is something that I think we all desire. I believe that as we pray for the blessing and we pray for the influence, if we see this for what it really is, and where he is right now in your life, this could just be the game changer. This could be the day that you go back and you realize, because here's the thing, his presence is in you. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. If God be for us, who could be against us? My God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ. We pray for presence, because what he says here is, let your hand be with me. Let your hand be with me. Acts 11, 21 says, the Lord's hand was with them, and a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord. The Lord's hand. Man, can you imagine if we allow the beautiful, powerful presence of God in our lives, his hand, his heart, his life, his ideas, his desire for you to be with you. Sure, you're going to have influence. Sure, you're going to live a blessed life because you're recognizing that he is with you. Exodus puts it this way. Then Moses said to him, if your presence, I love this part. If your presence does not go with us, do not send us up from here. He says, how will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us? He says, what else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth? And the Lord said to Moses, I will do the very thing you have asked me. Moses is so sure about this one thing. He says, if you're not going with us, and if it's not going to be your presence that is revealed, if it's not Jesus Christ that is revealed in the lives of people, then I don't want anything to do with it, because they're not going to be able to distinguish between you or the world. And why would anybody want what I've got if they can't distinguish between me and the world? Because listen, we still are broken at times. We still want things to happen in our lives at times. And if we were totally vulnerable and transparent with the people around us, they wouldn't want what we have sometimes. But Moses said, God, I'm asking you. I'm asking that your presence, when we walk from this place, would go before us. And I'm asking that when the people see us, they don't even see us. They see you. Because we want them to see you before they ever see us. Listen to me. The reason why I say that is this. If we are ever going to see things that are unexplainable in this community, it has to be that every single time we arise from our houses and come to the house of the Lord, or come to serve here, or go to our jobs all week long, when people see us, they think, man, what in the world is different about that person? It's the presence of the living God that is in you, reigning in you, and it's all for his glory. And man, I would like to say, may we not even go to work if we think it's going to be us going to work, but may we just say, God, I'm not trusting my experiences. I'm not trusting my education. I'm not trusting my words. I'm not trusting my hard work. I'm not trusting anything there is about me, but I'm trusting the fact that when I walk in, you walk in with me, and may they see Jesus and not Tom Blount. We'll see things that the community will scratch their head and say, how can it be? Why is that church filled to capacity 3 and 4 and 5 times? Why is that church's parking lot to where you come in and go out? They can't, you know what I'm saying? You can't get in. It's an amazing, we can see that. Why? As long as we want people to see Jesus and not us. That's the key. God bless me. God, I'm asking that your hand would be with me, the influence that you have, and your presence would be with me. But here's the thing, you got to pray. Pray for protection. Pray for protection. Why? Because it's so key. He said, and keep me from harm. Here's a very key truth to all of our lives. And if you're not careful, I'm telling you what. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, he says, the devil is like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Listen, he is the King of Kings, and he is the Lord of Lords, and he is the Alpha and the Omega. But all Satan can do is imitate a roaring lion. He is not the lion. He can only imitate the roaring lion. Years ago, I used to hunt like a madman, but I still try to keep my priorities in place. And I kind of lost that love for whatever reason. It doesn't really matter right now. But here's the thing. I'm impressed by those who can do a turkey call or a goose call or a duck call or a bugle for an elk or a sika deer, a seka, whatever it is. And I'm listening to the thing. I'm like, what? And then it calls him in. All the devil can do is roar like a lion just to get you to come in. And he says, be very careful. Satan desires to sift you like wheat because he wants to destroy you. God has the very best for you. Pray for a blessing. Pray for influence. Pray for his presence to be real. Romans says this, and I want you to check this out, because it never, ever leaves the protection. You shall separate us. Who is it that shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? He says, no. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us so. What a promise. What a beautiful promise. Because what I want you to understand in the very last point, here's why we pray. Prayer isn't about God moving toward us. It's not about, oh, God, I need you to move toward me, because he's here. Do you realize that all of you that know beyond any shadow of a doubt that you are saved by the grace of God, when you walked in this auditorium, you brought Jesus with you. He's already here. Prayer is not about God moving toward us, but prayer is about us moving toward God. When we pray for a blessing, we're asking God, I can't do this without you. When we pray for influence, what we're saying is, God, if I'm going to have any impact in the community, if I'm going to have any success within my vocation, if I'm going to do anything that's really worth and valuable, it's got to be empowered by you. And God, I'm asking that your presence, your hand, would go before me. God, I'm asking that you would keep me from harm. Don't you for one moment allow Satan to interfere in my life. And the only way that takes place is me fixing my eyes upon Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross and despised the shame and is now set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Do you know why Jesus finished the work? Because he never took his eyes off his Father. Because his Father's will was that his Son would die upon the cross so that you could come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. You're blessed, you're favored, and you're loved all because of Jesus. Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, thank you. Thank you for this time that we have had together today, Lord, although it has been brief. It has been my prayer that in the midst of teaching and preaching in pain, that you would be glorified, that you would empower your people. That people would not see me, they would see Jesus. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, please, nobody looking around. Nobody looking around. I don't know how God is working in your life, but I do know this. Here's the very first thing you need to settle. I don't want you to hope for it. I don't want you to just think, I think I am. I want you to know. If you do not know beyond any shadow of a doubt that Jesus Christ is your Lord and personal Savior, that you are saved by the grace of God, I'm going to word a prayer. That this prayer basically says what the Word of God says, is that you need to admit that you're a sinner and you need to believe that Jesus Christ died upon the cross, and then you just need to confess it. And so right there, if you have a desire to be saved, not doubt it, but be saved and know it, would you call upon the name of the Lord right now? Why don't you say this? Lord Jesus, I'm asking right now, with all the faith I have, that you would come and save me from my sins. Because, Lord, I've fallen short. Save me from my sins. Come into my heart and be my Lord and Savior. It's my desire to live for you as your child. Father, there have been those that have called upon your name this morning, but I'm asking, Lord, all over this audience, that you would speak to every single person's life. And there is so much doubt, so much fear in all of our lives at times, that you'd bless them. That you, Lord, would bless them. That you would empower them today with influence beyond recognition.
in their family, in their vocation, in their community. Lord, I'm asking that your presence would be real in all of them and that you would keep them from harm. I pray all of this in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus, because it's your death and your burial and your resurrection that you have power to deliver us. And you have power that we might live above every sin. In Jesus' name, amen.